Good morning friends, let's continue with the lectures of the excretory system, that is your renal physiology. So in my previous lecture and the first lecture of this renal physiology, I have taught you about the basic anatomy of the kidney, including the nephron and the juxtaglomerular apparatus. The topic for the today's lecture is renal circulation, that is the renal blood flow or the blood supply to the kidney. Now you know that each and every organ in our body as a blood supply, that is basically to meet the nutritional demand. Similarly, the kidney also have a high blood flow. Okay? But here, as far as the blood flow of the kidney is concerned, okay, it is not only to meet the nutritional demand, but the most important significance of this blood flow, high blood flow basically, it is to have a removal of the metabolic waste product through the glomerular filtration. Now you know the basic function of this kidney is to filter the plasma and to remove the metabolic waste product. Okay, so that is another significance of a high blood flow to the kidney. Now just look at this picture and the flow chart that is showing the blood flow to the kidney. Now you can look at here, this is the kidney, the basic, just I am revising. Okay, this is the outer portion, that is the cortex, and this is the inner medulla, and here the medial concave portion, that is known as the renal hilum. Okay, through which the ureter and the renal vein, they are leaving the kidney, while the renal artery, it is entering the kidney. So now the major blood vessel that is supplying the blood to the kidney, it is via the renal artery. Okay, so that renal artery, it will divide into the multiple branches that are known as interlobar arteries, that will divide into arcuate arteries, that will divide into interlobular arteries, that will ultimately divide into efferent arterioles, that we have you have been taught during the nephron, structure of the nephron, that will continue as the glomerular capillary, and that capillary will combine to form efferent arterioles. Okay, so just look at here, so this is the major artery that is entering the kidney, that is the renal artery, that will divide into the segmental artery, and that will divide into the interlobar arteries, that means arteries in between the various lobes. Okay, now that interlobar artery, it will arch. Okay, so they will angle, here you can see this angle, so there, these branches are known as the arcuate arteries. Okay. Now, these arcuate arteries, it will give a multiple fine branches that are known as interlobular arteries. Okay. And that interlobular arteries, ultimately, it will continue as the efferent arterioles. That efferent arteries will enter the glomerular capsule to form a glomerular network through which they will exit as a efferent arterioles. So, now look at here, the efferent arteriole, it will continue as a peritubular capillary or as a vasa recta. That means if the glomerulus are present in the cortex, cortical nephron, then the efferent artery will divide to form a peritubular capillary network. If these are a juxtamedullary portion, then this efferent artery will divide to form a vasa recta, that is a loop. Okay, then they will continue as a vein, stellate vein, interlobular vein, arcuate vein, interlobar vein, and ultimately the renal vein, that will leave the kidney. So here the branches of the veins are almost running parallel to that of the arteries. Now this is a summary of this flow chart showing the blood flow. Okay, starting from the renal artery, that will divide ultimately to form efferent arterioles, that will form the glomerulus. Okay, that is the primary portion of the nephron, that will continue as efferent arteriole, that will either divide into the peritubular capillary or into the vasa recta. So this part, it is present within the nephron. Okay, and then they will continue as a vein and they will leave the kidney. So now this picture shows the peritubular capillary and the vasa recta. So you can see this is the arcuate artery that will divide the interlobular artery. Then here is the efferent arteriole that will enter the Bowman's capsule here, that is the glomerular capsule. Okay, where they are making the tuft of a glomerular network. And then that capillary will exit as a efferent arteriole, and that efferent arteriole, either it will continue as a peritubular capillary. Here you can see this is the peritubular capillary network around the cortical nephron. This is the cortical nephron. Okay, and similarly here, this is the efferent arteriole, and these are the efferent arteriole. In between here is the glomerulus. So here the efferent arteriole, it will continue as the vasa recta. You can look at it. This is vasa recta. Okay, so that is the capillary network around the juxtamedullary nephron. So here this vasa recta, basically it is looking like a loop. Okay, so both this vasa recta and peritubular capillary are having their own significance. So now coming to the characteristic of the renal blood flow. Okay, So kidney is receiving a high amount of the blood flow. Okay, so can look at this, the rate of the blood flow to the kidney is around 1200 ml per minute. Okay. And as far as the per unit gram of the tissue, if you see, then it is much higher than many of the other tissues. So it is around 400 ml per 100 gram tissue per minute. Okay. So though the kidney weight is concerned, the kidney weighs around 0.5% of the total body weight, but they are receiving around 20% of the resting cardiac output. That means the kidney are receiving a large amount of the blood flow in relation to the many other organs. Okay. So this higher blood renal blood flow related to its excretory function rather than its metabolic requirement. That means the other tissues that are receiving the blood flow, that will depend on their nutritional demand, their metabolic requirement. But here in the kidney, large amount of this blood flow is not to meet the demand of the kidney, but it is basically related to the excretory function, because the main function of this kidney is to filter the plasma and to remove the metabolic waste product. Okay, so the high renal blood flow is basically to its excretory function rather than its metabolic requirement. Now the basic importance of the renal blood flow. So first thing is, as far as all the tissues are concerned, similarly the kidney is also receiving the blood flow to receive the oxygen, nutrients and the hormones that will control their function. But in addition to this nutritional demand, the blood flow to the kidney is also important to deliver the metabolites and the waste product, okay, to the kidney for its excretion in the urine. Then this blood flow is also important to control the concentration and the dilution of the urine. It also influences the solute and the water reabsorption from the kidney, and it also determines the GFR, that is glomerular filtration rate. So now the kidney is receiving high blood flow, and depending on the need, this blood flow will be maintained. Okay? So that we have to discuss under this topic, that is the regulation of the renal blood flow. Okay? So the blood flow or blood supply to the kidney is regulated via basic three mechanisms. One is the autoregulation, that is kidney itself regulates its blood flow. Second is the hormonal regulation, and third one is the neuronal regulation. So we will discuss this one by one briefly. So before going to the regulation, just look at this picture. Okay, that is showing the relationship between the changes in the resistance of the efferent and the efferent arterioles, and that will ultimately decide the renal blood flow and the glomerular filtration rate. Okay, so look at this picture. Suppose this is the glomerulus, okay, initial portion of the nephron, where the efferent arterioles are entering and the efferent arterioles are leaving. Okay. Now suppose this is the efferent arteriole just before the glomerulus. Suppose there is a constriction of the efferent arteriole. That means there is a decrease in the diameter of efferent arteriole, then it will decrease the blood flow to the kidney, to the glomerulus. Okay. So this will decrease both the blood flow as well as the GFR. Now second picture is showing this. Suppose there is a dilatation of this efferent arterioles, okay, so that will increase the blood flow, and similarly it will also increase the GFR. Okay. Now look at this third picture. Here the efferent arterioles are normal, but the efferent arterioles, there is a constriction, there is a decrease in the diameter, so that will increase the GFR by increasing the hydrostatic pressure, but it will decrease the renal blood flow, because the blood flow from here to here, it will decrease because of this constriction. Then fourth picture, that is showing the efferent arterioles being normal in the diameter, but efferent arterioles are dilated. There is a vasodilatation of the efferent arterioles, so where it will decrease the GFR because of decrease in the hydrostatic pressure here, and it will increase the renal blood flow. That means it will increase the blood flow to the peritubular capillary and the vasa recta. Okay, so these are the just basic determinants that will helpful during study of the renal regulation. So now first is the autoregulation. That means kidney itself, they are maintaining their blood flow. Okay. So the blood flow to the kidney is maintained at a relative constant level despite a change in the systemic pressure between 80 to 180 millimeter of the mercury. That means if the blood pressure is ranging within this limit, arterial blood pressure, then kidney can maintain their blood flow at a required rate. And this is known as the autoregulation. But beyond this range, that means if the blood pressure is below 80 or it is beyond 180 millimeter mercury, then kidney will not able to maintain that blood flow by their own. Okay. Now again, there are two mechanisms by which the kidney can maintain their blood flow. One is the myogenic mechanism and second is the tubuloglomerular feedback mechanism. So myo means the muscle, that you know. So myogenic mechanism, so that will depend on the strength of the vascular musculature, smooth muscle. So now just see the step here. Suppose there is increased blood pressure, increase in the blood pressure, then it will increase the stretch over the vessel wall. Okay, that means there will be stretching of the vessel wall. So that will cause opening of the calcium channel, resulting in the rapid depolarization. Because influx of the calcium, it will cause rapid depolarization. So that will cause a vasoconstriction. Now you have studied this mechanism in the mechanism of the muscle contraction. Okay, influx of the calcium in the cardiac muscle shell, it will cause its contraction. So this increased pressure, ultimately it will lead to the vasoconstriction. That means because of increased pressure, if there is increased blood flow, but by this vasoconstriction, the increased blood flow will come to the normal. Second is a tubuloglomerular feedback mechanism. So as far as the name suggests, tubulo, that means there is a certain factor present within the tubules, renal tubules. Okay, change in the pressure within the tubules, it will send the signal to the glomerulus, and then via that feedback mechanism, it will maintain the blood flow. Okay. Now suppose there is increased blood pressure. Okay, increased blood pressure, that will increase the renal arterial pressure too. Okay, so that is causing increased renal blood flow, and similarly it is also causing increased GFR. So increased GFR, it will cause increased concentration of sodium chloride within the renal tubular fluid. So that will be sensed by the macula densa. That is a part of the juxtaglomerular apparatus that we have discussed. Okay. Now, through this macula densa cell and the juxtaglomerular apparatus function, by this feedback effect, this will cause a constriction of the efferent arterioles. Okay. And you know, the constriction of efferent arteriole, it will decrease the renal blood flow. Constriction will decrease the renal blood flow, and parallelly it will also decrease the GFR by a negative feedback mechanism. So this increased renal blood flow and increased GFR via this negative feedback mechanism, it will come towards the normal. Okay. Now second probability, suppose there is decreased blood pressure, so that will decreasing the renal blood flow, and similarly it also decreasing the GFR. Okay. So decreased GFR, it will cause a decrease in the sodium chloride concentration in the tubular fluid, that will again sensed by the macula densa. Okay. And decreased sodium chloride concentration, it will cause the release of the renin by this macula densa, and by this renin angiotensin system, okay, this will cause the increased blood flow, as well as it will cause the dilatation of the efferent arterioles. Okay, so the dilatation of efferent arteriole, it will have a positive feedback mechanism, and it will increase the renal blood flow. Okay, and this dilatation of the efferent arteriole will also increase the GFR. Okay, so in this way, this tubuloglomerular feedback mechanism will work. Now second part of the regulation, it is the hormonal regulation. So just this chart is showing a brief about the hormonal regulation. So there are two types of the hormones of the or the chemicals that are acting as a vasoconstrictor, or another group that is acting as a vasodilators. Okay, so most of this vasoconstrictor, they will decrease the renal blood flow, and also it will decrease the GFR ultimately. So important vasoconstrictors like norepinephrine, angiotensin 2 and the endothelin, they will constrict the efferent arterioles, and they will decrease the renal blood flow. Okay. And the vasodilators like prostaglandins, nitric oxide, bradykinin, atrial natriuretic peptide, glucocorticoids, dopamine, all they will increase the renal blood flow. Then final regulation, it is via nervous mechanism. And mainly the importance here, it is the sympathetic nervous system. Okay. So any factor that is causing a stimulation of the sympathetic fibers to the kidney, okay, and the effect of sympathetic nervous system, it is a vasoconstriction. And you know, the vasoconstriction, it will decrease the renal blood flow. Okay. So the stimulation of a renal sympathetic fiber, it will cause a vasoconstriction, and it will decrease the renal blood flow. Okay. So the mechanism here is the sympathetic stimulation that will increase the renin release. Renin will cause activation of the renin angiotensin system, and they will form the angiotensin 2. And you know, the angiotensin 2, it is having a vasoconstriction effect. Okay, so in this way, by doing vasoconstriction, the sympathetic stimulation, it will decrease the renal blood flow, as this effect it is seen whenever you are doing the exercise. Okay, so at the time of the severe physical exercise or any stress, the vital organs will require the high blood flow. Okay, like a heart basically. Okay, so here the blood flow will be diverted from the kidney to the heart. Okay, so in this way the sympathetic system will decrease the renal blood flow to the kidney. Okay? And with this system, this local prostaglandins are also secreted. So this local prostaglandins like prostaglandin E2 and I2, they are having an opposite effect. They are doing a vasodilatation. Okay, so with the exercise, as I give an example, with the exercise there is sympathetic stimulation that will decrease the renal blood flow, but with that, during that, there is also release of the local prostaglandins that will do the vasodilatation. Okay, so that will maintain the blood flow. Okay, so except the extreme stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system, the vasoconstriction will be nullified by the vasodilatation. But if there is an extreme stimulation of the sympathetic system, then it will ultimately decrease the renal blood flow only. So this is just a flowchart showing the effect of the blood flow to the kidney. If there is a decreased blood flow, okay, then via this regulatory mechanism, the blood flow will be normalized, the blood pressure will be normalized by these various mechanisms. Okay. All about the today's lecture, renal circulation and its regulation. This is a very short topic, but it is important. Okay, so thank you very much and have a very nice time ahead.